Okay. How many people here are from the engineering school? Raise your hand. All right, good. All these techies. So, first question, if you notice that in the participant guide you got today, it's all about invention to venture, right? And the biggest problem that, the biggest problem we see as technology investors is that there is a great asymmetry of information between the people who are starting these companies and the people who are investing them. We see lots and lots of companies, but we see lots of technologists, lots of people coming out of engineering school, brilliant people, great ideas, who don't understand the intricacies of starting a venture, turning technology into innovation. And the biggest disconnect is what happens in the press. As Sri was just saying, you know, social media is wonderful. All this stuff that you can find in the blogs is great. The only problem is it doesn't, in some case, match with reality. So if you are a technologist and you read TechCrunch and you read all these posts coming out of Silicon Valley, the assumption is, oh, you wake up one morning, you got a great idea, you walk down the street into a Starbucks, you get meet a venture capitalist who gives you a couple million bucks. 6 months later, you get yourself funded, and then a year and a half later, you sell to Facebook, and then you retire to an island somewhere. That's not quite the way it works. So what I'm going to do this morning is to give you a more realistic view of this world. And I'm going to start by taking you through the example of a person you may or not have heard of. His name is John Goodhill. He's a technologist, inventor, and entrepreneur. And this is going to show you that this is a real person. This is not the way 6 months you get funded. This is a long time investment. And there's a lot of Sturm und Drang. And if you look at the participant guide, it'll tell you, are you ready to be an entrepreneur? Do you know what it takes? It's tough. So this is a guy who didn't come right out of school and start going. He started at 34 years old into the entrepreneurial world with his first business. He had an idea for his invention when he was 36. He then started to work on this a little bit by doing some consulting work with other folks out there. He founded his second business with some partners when he was 38. He got his partners to contribute $400,000 to get his business going. Unfortunately, it didn't work, and it blew up. And then, you know, back to the drawing board again. So then, now he's 46 years old. So this is a whole career in here. He founded a third business. He did a friends and family round, raised $150,000. But then he really had faith in his idea, good you know, technologist, was working on this stuff, and managed to start romancing VCs so they knew who he was, so that when he came back a couple of years later, he founded his fourth business. He raised a $800,000 Series A VC round, started working on the product. It was promising. The only problem was, like many things in the entrepreneurial world, it took longer and it cost more, so he ended up doing a couple of years later a Series B. Another $800,000. This is a flat valuation round over there. By now he's 54 years old, right? So he's working at this for 20 years. He missed his budgets, he missed his deadlines, and then in something that doesn't happen all that often, but it happens, the whole thing blew up again. He ended up, in this particular case, the VCs took over his company. Okay, boom. He's now 59 years old. He founds his fifth business. This time he goes to angels. And he then, as a 59, 60-year-old innovator and technologist, is out there starting again. And it's finally not until he's 67 that he is actually recognized and comes out with the invention of the year as an overnight success. So, this kind of 30-year career with all of this stuff and all this financing and all this invention is not atypical. And now, when we say invention of the year, it really wasn't the invention of the year. It was the invention of the decade. Actually, it was the invention of the century. As a matter of fact, it was actually the invention of the millennium, because this person, John Goodhill, was actually Johann Gutenberg. And his invention was printing. So I am going to quickly walk you through the details of Johann Gutenberg and his angel venture financing and his multiple businesses over here. So let's take a look and see what actually happened in the real world to Johann Gutenberg. So he starts out in 1398, where he is born in Mainz. He came from a sort of upper class family of patricians over there. He goes off to school. He becomes a jeweler. The family was involved in the mint and in goldsmithing. So he becomes a jeweler. And at that point in his town, the patricians got sort of kicked out of town when the unions came in, so he moved to Strasbourg. He opens his business as a jeweler. He needs to raise some money, so he's actually a very smart guy, good technologist, good jeweler. So a guy named Andrew Dritzen says, hey, can you teach me how to learn polishing stones and jewelry? So he does that, and that's how he starts getting some money. 2 years later, he actually starts his first entrepreneurial venture. This is a trinket business. They are making looking glasses, which they are selling to pilgrims who are coming to a nearby town for a religious pilgrimage. They make these looking glasses. They sell them to pilgrims. It happens every couple of years, and it's a decent business. So he's making some money at this. On the side, he starts working on this big, hairy, audacious goal that he has to change the world with this really cool technology he has in the back of his mind. But he keeps going, and then his former student in the jewelry business, Dritzen, comes along and says, you're an entrepreneur. I want to be an entrepreneur too. So can you teach me how to make these looking glasses and these trinkets and sell them to pilgrims? And so another guy heard that this guy Dritzen was going to learn how to do this, and he said, Andrew Heilman, can I come in and learn too? So Gutenberg said, all right, well, he needed money to start funding his invention on the side. So he took $150,000 from actually the families of these two guys to teach them how to make trinkets, and so they could set up in business themselves making these looking glasses for the next pilgrimage. The only problem was, after they had paid him the money and they started doing this stuff, the pilgrimage got canceled for the next year. So they were sort of all dressed up with no place to go, and they were saying, okay, well, it's not going to do us any good to make looking glasses if there's no pilgrims to sell them to. So these two guys said, hey, Gutenberg, well, we got all this knowledge, but we can't use it, and we know that you keep sneaking off to the basement because you've got some secret thing down there. So tell you what, how about if we take this stuff and we buy into whatever your secret is, because we know you're a smart guy. Therefore, after the pilgrimage is postponed, he starts his second business. And this is a joint venture. So the guy that Gutenberg was in business with, Hans Griff for the trinkets, they bring in these two young guys who get their families to upfront a whole lot of money, effectively about $400,000 at that time. So they're investing $400,000 in this partnership and $800,000 pre money valuation. And so they get a third of the business. And the idea is Gutenberg will tell them all his secrets that he's doing, whatever that secret thing is down there. And so they set up this partnership, and they're pretty rational, and this is well documented, because it's this all, there are no patents then, so this is a whole trade secret thing. Very, very secret. They have a buy-sell agreement, so if one of them dies, the others get to buy out his interest in exchange for, no further involvement, and nobody else can come into this secret thing for $100,000 at the end of 5 years. Everything seems to be going okay. And then, of course, everything hits the fan because Dritzen dies. And that triggers the buy-sell. And all of a sudden, he's now been putting a lot of money in. He's a bright young thing, and he keeps funding money into this operation of Gutenberg's. And his family says, well, wait a minute. We actually want to be part of this thing, too, whatever he was getting at. So all of a sudden, some strange pieces of equipment disappear that Gutenberg tried to go and secure as soon as Dritzen died, and the whole thing goes to court. And the relatives of Dritzen sue Gutenberg to get in on this action, and ultimately they lose. Gutenberg wins. He has to pay him only $15,000 to get out of this business, he moves forward. So the partnership at that point ends, and Gutenberg goes back to the drawing board, keeping the goodies, stuff that he had hidden in his basement. So what was Gutenberg's great invention? We all think Gutenberg invented the printing press. What does that actually mean? There were two things in particular that were critical to Gutenberg's invention, right? The first of them was the press. Not because there hadn't been presses before, there had been. But it turns out that if you are trying to print a whole page of type, like a book, you need a whole lot of pressure. And the only way you can get that whole pressure in there is to brace your press against the ceiling with a whole sort of screw thing. So this was based on a screw press, hit to the ceiling, and that was the first piece. And the second piece was even more critical. And this is something that people don't realize, but the key invention of Gutenberg was actually the mold to cast metal type. And that's what this is. This is a reproduction of a typecasting mold where you can take metal and you pour it in, and because you'll see this is like an L-shaped thing, the two pieces slide back and forth, that means that even if the width changes of the piece of type, the tops and bottoms are all aligned, so you can lock it up by friction together and it won't fall apart. And so that was Gutenberg's key invention. So he takes this stuff time marches on. Finally things have settled down a little bit back in his hometown of Mainz. He goes back to Mainz, and he's still working on this stuff. So he raises a friends and family round of $150,000. A lot of money going to this thing so far, right? Guaranteed by a family member, he begins starting to talk to VCs, including this guy Johann Fust, who was the sort of biggest VC in town. And then the fourth business, 1450, finally, he's been showing off some, in secrets, quietly, some examples. He wasn't quite at the prototype stage yet, but he had enough to interest this VC in investing. And so Johann Fust invests $800,000 at a 6% preferential return, secured by all the assets of the business, to go ahead and fund Gutenberg's operation. Things don't always go as expected, but Gutenberg starts off by hiring staff. When you get funded, you can now hire people, so it's not just you. One of the guys he hires is this UI designer, a guy named Peter Schuffer, who had been educated in Paris, typographer, type designer, and actually a scribe, because he was doing stuff in printing. And so the shop, with Fust's money and Gutenberg's technology and Schuffer's design skills, gets set up, and here you have Gutenberg over here and his assistant, Peter Schuffer, printing stuff here on the press. Okay, but they start printing. Now Gutenberg does something that is not exactly something we would approve of as investors. He keeps his little print shop on the side. So around the corner, he's got his own original little print shop, and he's using his own little press to print out some things to make some money on the side. Meanwhile, the press he's got with his partners, Fust and Schuffer, begins to print some stuff as well, little test things, mostly things like indulgences, right, from the Pope, because they were good sellers. The problem, however, is that things take longer and cost more, as always, so he raises a Series B from Fust, because he's now showing that he can actually print things. So they got the press functioning, he's gotten stuff out of there, they're selling it, so they're making a little bit of cash on it, but nowhere near the amount they need, because this big, hairy-ass goal that he's talking about is to create the Bible, to print this big Bible, this big book. Lots of type, lots of pages, lots of copies, never been done before, creating a whole new market over here. So he gets another $800,000 from Fust. At this point, Fust is getting a little antsy because Fust actually has to go out and borrow the money to invest in Gutenberg over here. At this point, there's close to $4 million in total in this operation from Fust and from the guys who came before and from Gutenberg's own money and all kinds of stuff in here. But unfortunately, things really get to be problematic. Gutenberg has now got his little shop on the side printing indulgences, and he's got his thing with his partners printing indulgences while they're trying to print the big Bible over here with all their workmen. So there's a little beehive of activity sitting there in Mainz with stuff going on. Unfortunately, at that point, this is now several years later, he goes back to Fust and says, oh, guess what, we're still not, we've missed our budgets again, missed our deadlines, need more money. And Fust says, okay, enough is enough. I borrowed this cash. I got $2 million in this operation. You don't have any finished things yet over here, so forget it. I'm foreclosing on this note. You haven't paid me interest in 4 years. You want more money. This is way beyond what I expected for it. So at that point, the thing blows up. Fust, his VC, forecloses on the entire operation. It goes to court, and basically Gutenberg loses the court case, and Fust gets all the Bibles that were just about ready to be published but haven't been printed yet, plus the press, plus the type, and everything else. And then to add insult to injury, Peter Schuffer, who was Gutenberg's assistant over there, actually sides with Fust and goes off. And so here you have his effectively his COO or his CTO, along with his VC, taking over the company, taking over the books, taking over the equipment, and they are ultimately the ones who produce the Gutenberg Bible. So So the Gutenberg Bible was not published by Johann Gutenberg. It was published by Johann Fust and Peter Schoeffer. So what happens over there? Well, Gutenberg slinks off, takes the, remember he still had another little shop around the corner with a small amount of equipment, so he takes that. He goes now to another angel over here, a guy named Conrad Homery in Mainz, and he gets a little bit of cash. He's now 59 years old over here. And he starts with his little press and his typecase over here. He starts setting some small things, doesn't print giant books, is printing some smaller things. Meanwhile, Fust and Schoeffer, his former partners over here, actually produce the Gutenberg Bible, which they manage to pre-sell for a fair bit of cash. They then go on from there because they've now got it down to a science. And if anybody here has ever tried printing letterpress by hand, it's a big operation. So to print that whole Bible took lots and lots and lots of stuff and people and so on. Their next big book was the Mainz Psalter, which is a gorgeous book, the first thing printed with the initials printed in two colors over here. And so these guys, at that point, Schoeffer becomes a partner, full partner with Fust, and the best way to seal this thing is you marry him off to your daughter. So Peter Schoeffer marries the daughter of Johann Fust. Then, of course, bad things happen all the way around, and the town of Mainz gets sacked. There's all these religious stuff going on, and so these hordes come in, the archbishop comes in. Back then, archbishops had armies, so they came in and sacked the town. However, because there were no patents here, this was all trade secrets, all those workmen who were printing, and it took a lot of workmen, dozens, to print this whole Bible and the Psalter and so on, they end up getting dispersed, the presses get dispersed, and then what you see all of a sudden is poof, around all of Germany, around all of Europe, printing spreads like wildfire because all the people who now knew the secret, the cat's out of the bag, each person kept it to themselves, but their people who they employed to be their workmen went out and started their own presses over here. Finally, it's not until 67 years old that Gutenberg is finally recognized, not quite a broken man, but certainly not a rich guy over here. 40 years after starting this operation, by the Archbishop of Mainz as a hero and the guy who really invented printing. They erect statues in his honor. They give him a nice little annual prize and some income, and he is the hero over here. And then a few years later, he only enjoys this for a couple of years. Gutenberg dies in 1468. Fust had actually died a couple of years before that. Peter Schoeffer hangs out another 30 years after there. And we're running out of battery power over here. So hold on a second. If we can plug that in, it'd be helpful. Suffice to say that the end of the saga is that Gutenberg dies. He gets some credit for printing. He was in a state of flow for much of his life. If any of you are familiar with flow, it's where you get your pleasure and your optimal experience from doing something. So this was a guy who was a serial entrepreneur. He had started several companies. He invented something that changed humanity forever. And if you want to see what it looks like, I happen to have brought a Gutenberg Bible here for you. So this is actually a page from the Gutenberg Bible over here. And during the break, if you'd like to take a look, you may actually see it. And what's amazing about this particular technology is this is a technology that started from the top and went backwards. This Bible, as you'll see when you look up closely, is the best book ever printed. It was really extraordinary. The design by Schoeffer, the types and the page layout was wonderful. The paper is great. The inking and the impression, the alignment, everything is just superb. This book has not been equaled in the 550-odd years since Gutenberg printed his Bible over here. And so there you go. The legacy of Gutenberg by the 100th anniversary of his birth in the incunabula period before 1498, there were over 30,000 books, 30,000 different titles that had been printed in over 15 million volumes. and the course of history had been changed, the most important entrepreneur inventor in history is Johann Gutenberg, and his legacy today is the Bible. And so that's an example of an inventor, an entrepreneur, a technologist, and somebody who had the fortitude to spend 30, 40 years pursuing his dream, pursuing his vision through ups and downs, and therefore, as we say, you know, plus ça change, plus c'est la même chose. The more things change, the more they say the same. Welcome to Invention to Venture. Thank you.